Hello everyone, this is the first episode of our Chan and Tea Talks on the roof. As you can see, this is the rooftop of one of the buildings at Nanputuo Temple in Xiamen City, Fujian Province. Okay, so as you all know, my Dharma name is Daojing. You can call me Venerable Daojing, or Daojing Fashi, or Daojing Shifu, whichever works for you. And as requested, some people would like to hear Dharma as well as about tea in English. So here we are making these videos on the roof in English. And these talks will be pretty short. It serves as an introduction to Chan and Tea. So one of the questions I got asked was, what is this Chan and Tea and how do they relate to each other? Well, there's a video that my master gives a talk in on this topic, so we can watch that one. So I'll talk about another aspect of it. So first of all, this Chan is the Chinese word for Zen, and Zen, this word actually comes from Chinese, so it's Chan. And Chan in Sanskrit is Jhana. So what is it? It's an insight into the nature of the mind. So this insight into the nature of the mind is us seeing into our mind's true nature, and that is the Buddha nature within all of us. So not only is Chan this insight into the mind, we can also define it as a state of mind and a way of practice. And then in fact, it evolved into a Chan school on its own. In China, we have the eight major Mahayana schools of Buddhism, Mahayana Da Sheng. So these eight schools include a Chan school because Chan is directly pointed into the mind and is outside of the transmission of the doctrine. Therefore, some people find this very attractive, and in the course of history, this is very advantageous because when these emperors decided to destroy temples and burn down scriptures, people who practiced Chan and also the Pure Land School managed to survive because they don't rely as much on the doctrine. So therefore, it evolved into a very popular school as we can see today in this world. So now we practice this Chan and eventually, we will awaken to our very nature, that's our Buddha nature. We not only gain awakening, we also gain wisdom and compassion to benefit all sentient beings, like the Buddha. So if we know the history of the Chan school, it goes down from Buddha to Mahakashyapa and is transmitted all the way to the 28th patriarch Bodhidharma, who then transmitted it to China. Now, what we have to understand is that Chan does not equal to the Chan school. Chan as a practice method developed into a school, but Chan itself does not equal the Chan school. So, Chan, we can actually practice this using many methods. For example, we have sitting meditation, we have reciting the Buddha's name, we have reading the scriptures, we have prostrations, etc. Many, many ways there are to practice Chan. But how does this relate to tea? Well, as we know, the best tea grows in pristine places, such as deep in the mountains, away from pollution, away from noise, away from people who may tamper with it. And in fact, when we do practice, we have the same kind of expectation. We practice best in an environment where there's no other things bothering us, such as other people, city noises, all sorts of temptations. So in fact, these two are similar in that aspect, where the best tea, as well as the best practitioners, tend to find themselves away from the crowded places, away from the pollution, and deep in the mountains. So that's where you'll find the best tea. And in history, when these Chan practitioners, they're monks usually, Buddhist monks, who have left the home life, they live in these mountains. The tea is then used as a tool by these monastics as well. The monastics then drink the tea, and the tea has many benefits. So these two complement each other. The best tea is then harvested by these hardworking monks, who then are able to make the best use of this tea in order to end up becoming better practitioners. These monks would harvest the tea, make the tea, and it would aid greatly in their practice. And that is how tea relates to Chan.